can start whenever you want.
Good morning. It's August 26th, 1998. We are in the chambers of Justice Eugene Primo in downtown San Jose in the California Court of Appeals, 6th District. Behind the video there is the ever-gracious Leslie Masanaga. And we thank you, Leslie, for doing this. My name is Mark Thomas, and we're here to get a little bit about the history of Justice Primo. Justice Primo, you have a really illustrious history as far as your ancestry here in California. Could you relate that somehow to us?
I wish you'd give me a little advance warning on that, because I'm not an expert on it. But basically, it's on the Spanish side of the family, which is my mother's side, and her ancestry comes from the Monterey County, Salinas Valley area, where her family had one of the original Spanish land grants, and along the what is now the River Road area in Salinas, Salinas River, and that goes back to the early 19th century, where the land was deeded from the crown and so forth. So there's a lot of history there on the Spanish side, although my grandmother on the mother's maternal side came from Ireland, so I'm proud of that too. Anyway, but the family was connected to the last governor under Spanish rule of California, the first governor, Peter Burnett, and we're all related in there too, so heard a lot about that when I grew up.
And then when did your ancestors come to Santa Clara?
Well, they rest of the family came from Spain, Barcelona area, in I think the date was 1830, 1840. Mm-hmm. The first person to arrive, that would be Fajo, F-A-T-J-O, and he was sent over here as a young boy to be educated all by himself, and landed in Santa Clara and started the Santa Clara clan, and then married into the rest of the family that had the Spanish connection in Monterey County.
And then your father practiced medicine.
My father came to San Jose from Creighton Medical School in 1933, and started practice here in San Jose first, and then after World War II, he served in the military. After World War II, he moved his office to Santa Clara. And then my grandfather started the First Bank of America. He was the manager of the First Bank of America in Santa Clara, so we had a lot of ties. And in that very building, as it turns out later on, I hung out my shingle and I became a lawyer for 1962, I guess it was. That was the same building, incidentally, where my father had a medical office, and my grandfather had started the bank down below. So.
Okay. Now, is that building still there?
No, that was on Franklin Street. That was those buildings are all gone now. Yeah.
Now, where did you go to high school?
Went to high school at Bellarmine Prep, which was the local Catholic school, and college at Santa Clara.
And then you graduated?
I graduated undergraduate in 1957. And went into the military and came back and went to law school at Santa Clara and finished in 62.
And what were you in? Weren't you in something in the intelligence in the?
I was in the ROTC in undergraduate, and a large group of my class was put into Army counterintelligence, which was interesting work, and a lot better than walking around in the infantry.
Were you spies, or what would you guys
do?
No,
we were doing security clearances for the Army, clearances for the people in the Army and the military. Same work that the FBI was doing for civilians.
Oh, I see.
And the Navy had their own group too. So anybody that was in the Army that was applying for a top secret security clearance had to be investigated in there. So we did the background checks and then did reports. I was stationed in the Midwest myself. So it was interesting, and I think in a way it was good preparation for my work in law school and practicing law too.
And then you started law school when?
Started in 59, graduated in 62.
Were the with the, all the problems of the 60s, were they starting to emerge then, or was Santa Clara pretty still?
No, it was too early then. The turmoil in society started, as I remember it, about 1970, 68 to 70. I went on the bench in 69 in municipal court, and that's where I first encountered it.
I see.
And I think it was about the time I went on the bench, maybe probably more like 1970.
Now, your law school class, was that a pretty small group?
The whole school was small. I think there were maybe 100 students in my class. There must have been more than 100, but my class had about 30, 35 graduating.
And then you distinguished yourself by being on you were the editor of the Law Review.
They started the Law Review. We didn't have a Law Review at Santa Clara, and Dean Heward had come from Georgetown and was trying to make the law school a little more sophisticated. So he started the Law Review, and I was the first editor.
And then you went into practice.
Then I went to the Court of Appeal in San Francisco as a research attorney. In those days, there were one-year jobs, 1 year, and then you moved on. And it was a paying job. I was married and had a child. And I was interested in that, so I applied and was accepted. Actually, I think the first Santa Clara graduate ever to work in the Court of Appeal. It was unheard of in those days.
Well, now, in your present staff, do you have any one-year people? Or
no. Now, in those days, in San Francisco, each judge had just one research attorney. And most of them were full-time people, but some of the judges rotated. And in those days, we only did the judges only did four cases a month, and you could live with that. They had pretty good ideas how to write their opinions, and they were shorter opinions. They were only 4 or 5 pages. But over time, the work got more sophisticated and more difficult. And now the attorneys are career people, very well paid, and it is a career. So my attorneys are all middle-aged people who have been here for some time now.
How many do you have?
I have 3, and they've all been with me. I came on board in 1988, and these attorneys have been with me the whole time.
Wow. So then you're in the verified atmosphere of the appellate court in San Francisco, and then you do that for a year, and then what happens?
And then I came back to San Jose, my hometown, and hung out my shingle. Didn't have any idea what was going to happen next. You could do that in those days. You've got the lowest overhead you could find, and then you went to the local court and said, I'll take court appointments. We didn't have a public defender, as you probably remember. And so I would go over there and put on a preliminary hearing for $25 or something. That's how I made my living for a while. And then eventually I associated with other lawyers in Santa Clara, and then moved to San Jose before I was appointed.
Well, who did you associate with in Santa Clara?
Dick Christie, who is still over there. It was Judge Kelly's former office, and he was in the same building with me when I started, but there wasn't any room. So ultimately, we had to get out of that building, and we went to another building, and I associated with him. And then after a few years, I moved down to San Jose and associated with Joe Henderson and Jerry Vannoli and Bill Dock.
I see. Okay. Now, somewhere during the practice period, you were very active in the barristers.
I joined the barristers, and ultimately I enjoyed that kind of activity, and I was the state vice president at one point, and the president locally here. And that, because of that activity, I met Board of Governors of the State Bar, and that's ultimately how I was appointed to the bench, because of those contacts.
I see.
And they had an opening in Santa Clara, which of course is my family's hometown. I think, as a matter of fact, it was Judge Kelly's elevation of Superior Court that caused the opening.
I see.
And so they approached me, and I was pretty young. I didn't think I was ready to go on the bench, but they told me, we may not come back and ask you again. So, in other words, opportunity only knocks one time, and that was the case with me. So I went on the municipal court at a pretty young age, 33.
I see. Now, where was your court in Santa Clara?
Well, it was located in the Civic Center in Santa Clara, which is still there, although the building is not used as a court. While I was there, I participated in building a new court building over at Homestead, which we supervised and went through all the labor, but then when it was built, I was gone, so I was over in Superior Court, so I never sat there, actually. But there was need for an expansion. It was a very small building next to the police department, which was handy, but we just outgrew it.
I see. How long were you on the Munich Court?
I was on the Municipal Court 5+ years, 69 to 74.
And then you were elevated to Superior Court when?
Right. The end of 74, which would have been the last month of Governor Reagan's administration.
Well, that, you must have gone on the Superior Court at the same time I went.
I went on the same time as you. In fact, I have some real yellow newspaper clippings of all of us raising our right hand, so, and which I still have. I don't want to file it away. So.
And then you were on the Superior Court until 1988.
Right. Then I sat 1975 to 1988. I came over here in the fall of 1988, and I had previously been assigned here twice as a judge pro tem to fill vacancies. 1985 and then earlier in 87 or 88. So I was kind of familiar with the operation of the court when I got here, which was very helpful.
Yeah. Now, during your term on the Superior Court, I assume that you were in just about everything. I think, weren't you PJ of the supervising judge of juvenile for a while?
Yeah, I did criminal law in motion and criminal trials to start with. I think that was my first assignment with the juvenile court, and I supervised that for 3 years, and then came downtown to San Jose and got into the family court and actually did the planning to set up the family court section, which we didn't have in those days. It became a four-division court by a change in the court rules. And I stayed there probably 3 years, and then I was assistant presiding judge, and then I was presiding judge in 1983. Then I went from there to civil trial work, got into complex litigation, which was just evolving in those days. And, that's where I was, what I was doing when I got the call to come up here.
Well, tell me a little bit more about your experience with the family court. It was your idea to change the system?
Well, the family court in those days, the family law situation was not good. 40% of the work in the court was family oriented, divorce and orders to show cause and so on, but there was no fixed calendar for it. It had grown enormously, and the calendar management concept had not really taken hold in those days. So I got a lot of complaints from lawyers, and I saw the calendar, the way the calendar is operated, and it was not satisfactory at all. But very hard on the litigants, and this was, well, I've forgotten the year, but Judge King in San Francisco was just starting to talk about family law as a specialty, although he was just doing law in motion, and the trials were going wherever they went, and a lot of judges were, not comfortable with doing those trials, they were very emotional and so forth. Well, and to make a long story short, with the help of some other judges, we changed the rules and set up permanent departments to just hear family cases. And since then, of course, it's gotten very complex and sophisticated. There are mediators and counselors attached to the court, none of which we had in those days.
And, that was really the beginning of the present.
That was the beginning of the present setup, and then other counties then came to Santa Clara County and saw what we did, and kind of fashioned their own departments. And so family law then became a real specialty for lawyers and judges, in effect. And then some good writers like Steve Adams and so on did academic work in that area, which really helped a lot. Now, of course, I don't know where they are now, but there are a lot of pro per litigants going through those courts now, and that's quite a change from when I was doing it.
What was it like being presiding judge of the Superior Court?
Well, it was a good experience. I myself did not mind administration and management, so I kind of enjoyed it. And of course, we had a terrific Superior Court bench. We always have in this county. And we're always blessed with very good cooperation from the lawyers of the county. And the whole time that I was on the trial bench, I felt that we had a superior relationship compared to other counties. I mean, there are other counties in the state that are good too, but our lawyers always supported our judges, and judges always supported each other, and we rotated out every year, if you remember. And, so, I mean, it was a very positive experience for me. That, unfortunately, the year I was presiding judge, we had lost five judges to retirement, or in the case of Justice Pennelly, an elevation. And I was left with only one judge to try civil cases by the end of the year. Mm. So the end of the year came just in time. So that was a problem. Trying to juggle criminal cases took precedent. It was a heavy criminal caseload, and it was difficult to keep moving. But, you know, we did. Everybody pitches together in those situations.
Now, when you say that you've been to the Court of Appeal before on a temporary basis, so did that maybe lessen the shock of it a little bit?
Well, I liked the work when I first got out of law school. I liked the way the Court of Appeal functioned. It was I had never been in the trial court, of course, but it was more of an academic environment where it was quiet and you had time to think and do your work. Whereas then I found out later in the trial court, you don't have any time to do anything. It's constant pressure in the trial court, which I don't miss at all. But then when I got over here, I could see that they have a lot of work, and they had a lot of work in those days in this court. It's kind of relentless, but you have people helping you, whereas in the trial court, you don't have too many people helping you. You're in there by yourself.
One of the things that I was very impressed with when I was on the Superior Court was one time I had a criminal case, and there was some type of a writ that had to be resolved, and we were there like at 9 o'clock, and you folks got this, and you, by 10 o'clock, you decided.
Yeah.
And your phone call came in, resumed the trial.
Well, we have an individual writ department, all courts of appeal do, and the writ department, that's their role. It's very difficult, too, is to absorb whatever they can of the case in very short order. And maybe half the time, there's a judge and jury and lawyers waiting down at the trial level, and we know that because we're told that. So those cases are given highest priority, and when the writ attorney is finished preparing the work, then it's circulated to the judges who are on the writ panel, and we do that immediately. It's signed by your name, and then the clerk's office notifies the trial court, which may be waiting. And you know, it is priority work, and we try to keep it, and we don't delay because it's important.
Have you had any cases that, over these many years, that were especially significant that you participated in? That
you mean at this level here?
Yeah.
Well, you know, they're all important. I like to think how many we do here, but probably in the thousands now since I've been here, so it's hard to single out a case, but there have been a couple of noteworthy cases that have gone to the Supreme Court, and new law has been made, which is kind of unusual. Mm-hmm. You know, there aren't too many cases out of all the thousands we see where new principles are going to be made, but once in a while we get one.
The attorneys seem to have a difference among themselves in the saying that, well, hey, the appellate court, even before oral argument, has already made up his mind, so why do we come in here and argue? And then others will say, oh no, they haven't made up their mind. What effect does oral argument have?
Well, I've heard those arguments too, but I've also seen cases where an effective oral argument will turn us around if we're on the fence on something, or if we have some questions that we want to ask and we're not clear on our take on the case, I mean, it's crucial to do it. A lot of other times, when the cases are routine, an oral argument's not going to make any difference in the case. In other words, you should be making the difference in your briefs. The written briefs are important. But oral argument is important from a lawyer's standpoint because you can get your only glimpse of how the judges may be thinking. Don't know who the judges are until you get there, so that's another important factor. And then you're there to answer questions if we have any questions. So I really think it's very important for the attorneys to make that oral argument. And of course, being persuasive and brief and so on is important too.
As you sit here and you're writing your decisions, do the events of the day affect you at all? I mean, like what's happened last week in politics or 2 weeks ago or 2 months ago?
No, I mean, we're obviously aware of our surroundings in our life, but that kind of thing doesn't enter into how we decide cases. I mean, it's not supposed to. Our personal opinions aren't supposed to enter into it. We follow precedent and one thing that does come into play, I would say, not as opposed to outside events, is our experience, especially our judicial experience. We fall back a lot on placing these cases into context based on your own experience, your own trial experience and litigation, either as a lawyer or as a judge. And most of my experience was as a judge. But a lot of the justices on the Court of Appeals had long litigation careers, for example. They know how to try cases and so forth. It is an advantage because you kind of are able to read between the lines and you're able to see what is important and what isn't important, even though there's argument on everything.
Mm-hmm.
And so our experience is a real factor, and I've been around a long time here now, and that's beginning to be very helpful to me.
Is the Court of Appeal, in fact, the court of last resort in the great majority cases?
In the great majority of cases, it is. There's some figure, and I think 94% comes to mind, but that may not be quite right. But most of the cases, of course, don't get appealed from the trial level. Those that do, most of them, our decision is the final decision, and then there's a small percentage that goes to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court only takes a smaller percentage of those. So we are, in effect, that way, the last resort on almost all cases.
When you make the decisions and then you say often reverse a judge who's heard this case, do the judges ever get mad that you reverse?
Well, I remember myself, you'd be annoyed if a reversal came back. And sometimes I remember reading the opinions and it wouldn't even look like the same case as I remembered it. But since I've been here, the amount of analysis that goes into the entire case at this level is much different than in the trial court. The trial court has, of course, the witnesses before it, and everything is happening quickly, and the trial judge has to manage the case and manage the jurors and worry about their comforts and keep the case moving because there's another case waiting and so forth. And so it's a different kind of pressure and a different kind of environment in the trial level, whereas up here, all of that is then reduced to the written page. Loses a lot of its glamour and pizzazz and so forth. And then we have the attorneys dissecting every decision, every ruling and so forth. Whereas the judge in the trial court has 30 seconds to make up his mind or her mind. Up here we can take 2 weeks if we want to. And so when that happens, you're going to find that the case law, which wasn't cited by the trial judge, really doesn't support his ruling or her ruling. Even though no lawyers cited any cases in the trial level, and the trial judge did the best he could, the case law turns out says that wasn't the right ruling. So that goes back, and I'm sure there are trial judges who take it personally, but that's the business.
Yeah. Yeah.
So no. we don't consider it a personal thing. We always consider that. We have great respect for the trial court because we know a lot of them and a lot of the judges, and we know how hard they work. So we have great respect, and there's some abiding principles in the Court of Appeal, one of which is to give great deference to the trial of fact and the trial judge, especially in abuse of discretion cases. So we uphold most of those decisions, really, because we have the principle that says that the trial judge is the one that's on the firing line, and really, as long as it's a fair exercise of his discretion, then we shouldn't interfere with it.
You mentioned right at the outset that when you first went to the Court of Appeal in San Francisco as an assistant, that they were doing, what, 4 cases a month?
4 cases a month was the caseload in San Francisco, which is a kind of a leisurely pace. We do anywhere from 12 to 15 per judge.
Yeah.
And then each, you know, we work in 3-judge panels, so each judge has 15 more cases. So, in effect, I have to read and sign off on 30 cases and write 15 myself per month. So that's what our workload is. Pretty substantial.
I don't expect you to have an answer on this, because I certainly don't, but you have the lowest level of the California judiciary is called justice. Justice of the peace. Then you have the 2 trial levels, they're judges. Then we get to the top level, now you're justice again. Is there any comment on that?
Well, I don't remember whether they called the justice of the peace justice when they addressed them. I don't remember that. No, I don't have an answer for that. That's historical, I guess.
And then one of the things I'm very interested in is, in the 3 levels of the judiciary that you've served in, where do you think you've had the most impact?
Impact on other people is what you're asking me?
Yeah.
I suppose, if you think about it, the contact with the majority of the public, between the judges and members of the public, happens in the lowest level. Municipal court, because that's where the average person has contact with the justice system through a traffic ticket or a small claims case, or smaller disputes, criminal cases, misdemeanors, and so forth. And I think, thinking back, that I probably saw more of the public in those days than in the other courts. Now, Superior Court, of course, there's more at stake as far as money goes. It's more expensive. Get lawyers and so on. I still had a lot of contact with the public and family court and the juvenile court, and I think I had, I guess my decisions impacted them more, at least more immediately. Whereas here, the only impact is on, that we see, is on the immediate litigants. On the other hand, we're making decisions that might affect the legal rights of other people that we never see. Because it's on, they're on the books. But I think the answer to your question is probably the lower court, where most of the people go, is where you have the most impact.
Justice Primo, I want to thank you for your courtesy, and I've enjoyed this, and I hope that our viewers in the future will enjoy it.
Always happy to be interviewed by Judge Mark Thomas. Thank you. Okay? Good, Mark.
Hey.
Pretty low pressure.